Yes, you do. Dream dreams and see visions. I love what it says at Pentecost. Your old people will dream dreams. Your young people will see visions. And I always say that you're never too old to dream a dream. You're never too young to have a vision. Speaking of that, I get a book in the mail. It was probably a couple months ago. I get a book in the mail from a woman who was watching my program, Live with Passion. She says, Father Cedric, you inspired me to write this book. My first book that I ever wrote. It was called God Recycles Broken Dreams. Nice title for a book. God Recycles Broken Dreams. So she says, thank you for inspiring me. I wanted you to have it. She sends it to me and then she puts P.S. It's my first book and I'm 88 years old. I thought that was good too. It's amazing. So what I'm simply saying, you're never too old and you're never too young. You got to push the boundaries. You got to risk. You got to dream dreams. Live with passion. Passion just isn't energy. It's facing your challenges. It's being creative. It's being determined. It's being ambitious. It's realizing that, you know what, you're made for more. You're made for more. And I'm talking about more of the professional things and realizing, you know, like Ford Company and building airplanes and things like that. That fantastic, what an age we live in. But I'm also talking about your spiritual life and about your moral life. We're called to grow there too. And I'll talk about that as we go on. Moral life tomorrow night and spiritual life Wednesday night when I talk about the Holy Spirit. But now we're talking about passion and potential and living with passion. And I know you want to do that. And that's my prayer for you. I really want to help the people of God. Can you imagine the impact of all the people in here? We've got younger people, older people, and we've got a lot of people in here tonight. Can you imagine how you could leaven Canton or wherever you live by going out there and realizing your potential? See, I believe that we can change the world. We can. Not we, but Christ in us, the hope of glory. And we heard the reading on Sunday, I can do all things. This is Paul the Apostle who has changed the world. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. That's so good, that strength. I talked to you about that on Sunday, that power. I was about ready to give up. I didn't think I had to call the priesthood. God anointed me. Said, Cedric, come on. I didn't hear a voice, but I could feel the power. So there's power for you, and there's power for me. And even if you don't feel it, believe it. And as you believe, you open your heart up to more. Let me continue to talk a little bit more about different things. I wanted to tell you about another book that I read that so influenced my life. It was in the novitiate 30 years ago. Before I professed my vows, you know, my novice master gave me this book, written by a man named Viktor Frankl. Viktor Frankl lived in a Nazi concentration camp. He was a Jewish psychologist, and he was helped by the Nazis in this camp. He saw life at its worst, at its most depraved, and he also saw people at their best. People were selfish and selfless. Have you ever heard of Maximilian Kolbe? I think you have, Franciscan saint, who died in a starvation bunker in the place of somebody else. That's like, what an attitude. In the midst of that concentration camp, here's this man giving his life for another man. Other people in concentration camps gave up. They said, this is too much for me. They ran into the electrified fence, or they allowed the guards to shoot him because they just wanted to die. They gave up meaning. They gave up hope. And so, what Viktor Frankl surmised, he said, that the greatest of all freedoms is the ability to choose your attitude in any given set of circumstances. Did you hear that? I know you're not in a concentration camp. You're in your homes. You're in school. I'm in a religious community. So this ought to be easier for us than it was for them in the concentration camp. He said the greatest of all freedoms is the ability to choose your own attitude in any given set of circumstances. That's right from his book. So it's not the circumstances that determine us. It's us that determine the circumstances. You have to get that. And if you don't get it, you're just going to be pushed around by life. You're going to let it throw you everywhere, but cut you everywhere, but loose. And it's time to stand up and be the man and the woman of God that you were called to be. And step up to the plate. I used to be afraid, you know, I was in baseball. Little League, and I used to be afraid to go to the plate because I would be afraid that I was going to strike out. And I'd be afraid to be out in the field because I was afraid that I was going to drop the ball. And I had the gift. I had the talent, but I was afraid. See, if you're a passionate person, you stand up to your fears. You live courageously. That's what I'm trying to do with my life. I'm just as scared as you are. I wasn't, you know, wasn't like when I was 2 years old, oh, I want to get up in front of people and speak. Panic attack me. It's scary for me, but I live courageously. I have determined in my own heart that I am going to face my fears, that I'm not going to just be in a little box the rest of my life, that I'm going to realize my potential. And I don't think I have any more potential than you do. I'm just being courageous. We've all got it. We're all made in the image of God. So anyway, I think Viktor Frankl, what he said was, so I don't know why I grew up so negative. You know, fear-based and afraid and thinking I can't do it. You know that there's two people in life that are absolutely 100% correct? You know who those two people are? Number one, people that say, I can do it. You know who the other person is that's 100% correct? The person that says, I can't do it. You got it. And it's so sad. And which one are you? So there you go. Well, anyway, I don't know what it was. You know, I grew up in a good family. Middle-class America, Massachusetts, had a good dad, had a good mom, two older sisters, had a good education. Why am I so negative? It's like it was my default setting in some ways. I remember one time, talk about complaints. They had an advertisement, they had a contest in our local newspaper, Springfield newspaper, Springfield, Mass. I don't want to go too long here. Springfield, Massachusetts newspaper. And they had a contest called, get this, Write a Gripe. Like, write a complaint. And they would pick one every once in a while, you know, of all the ones that are sent in. Guess who won the Write a Gripe contest? I was just a kid. I'm excelling in complaining. I had to be a grumpy young man or something. I don't know. You remember that movie, Grumpy Old Men? It was part two. So, you know what my gripe was? I hate dentists with bad breath. Sorry for any dentists out there. That was it. And they showed a picture of a young man, and here's a dentist over him with halitosis going on. The kid's going like this. It was great, I won money and everything, but next week I had to go to the dentist. So. I think some of the negativity came from TV. If you watch TV, of course we do, you'll see, like, the news shows will have, they'll kind of, not romanticize, but they'll aggrandize the news, you know, like, everybody's going to get Ebola. Now, for the first time today, I heard about, you know, Ebola fear. That's now a condition. People are, like, panicking that they're going to get Ebola. But I don't think so, but the way they're making it sound, it's like, don't shake anybody's hand. So, you know, the news does that, and then there were these sitcoms that would come across as kind of negative. And, for example, when I grew up, there was, remember Norman Lear's Archie Bunker, All in the Family? Yeah, we all used to watch that, most of us did anyway. We grew up with that. But Archie Bunker was the most bigoted, negative, prejudiced man that ever lived. He was crazy. And I was just in New York last week preaching that. That was dangerous, but anyway. He was very bigoted, but I liked him. I thought he was funny, because he was just hilarious. Well, one time, this is a little irreverent. You ready for a little irreverent? I didn't make this up, here it goes. Archie Bunker is being served animal tongue, by Gloria, by the family. They knew he wouldn't like it, because, you know, Archie just wants whatever he wants, when he wants it. They knew he wouldn't like it, so they try to distract him, you know, they're talking to him, they put the tongue right in front of him. Finally, he looks down. He goes, "What's this?" And his daughter, Gloria, goes, "Daddy, it's tongue. Eat it. You'll like it." He looks at him and goes, "Tongue? I ain't eating nothing that comes out of no animal's mouth." He goes, "Edith, go get me an egg." I think that's where some of the negativity comes in. So be careful what you're watching. Bible says, guard your heart, because out of it flow the issues of life. Guard your heart. You know, that voice, I can't do it, it's coming from somewhere. It's not necessarily you. That negativity, that thing that I'm always going to be this way, maybe other people can do it, but I can't. Because I know that voice. I still hear it. But remember, Piper Nike, we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. Say that. We are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. Can we say it like we mean it now? We are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. Okay, there we are getting there. So, we can face our challenges. You know, everybody has to deal with negativity, but even your negativity can catapult you higher. If you realize it and say, okay, wait a minute, everybody's got to deal with this. I can deal with this too. I'm special. I'm different. I'm unique. I'm anointed. I can do this. And I realize that everybody's got something. Relationship problems, depression, physical problems that you've got to deal with, monetary problems. Everybody's got something. As I said, some people have a lot of something. Many different things. So I wanted to tell you about Houston a little bit, really quickly. I'll draw this to a close. I'm aware of the time, but Houston, you know, I lived down there in Houston for 14 years now. When I was a seminarian, I actually did some ministry at the retreat center, and one of the people on retreat was a NASA engineer, because we have mission control in Houston. So he invited me to go to mission control. You know, we've all seen it on TV, and it looks real big and everything, but the first thing I thought was, this is really small. You know, it looks big on TV, but it's just a little room. Not a little teeny room, but it's not as big as it looked. And, but it was very complex. You want to talk about can-do people. These people at NASA, I mean, they're going to the moon, and sending spaceships up there to Mars, and to the edge of the universe, and the Hubble telescope, and all this different stuff. These are people who are living with passion, who are dreaming dreams and seeing visions. So, you remember what happened back in 1970. You know, we were sending men to the moon back then. And it was the third manned moon flight. It was called Apollo 13. Maybe you saw the movie back in 1995 with Ron Howard as the director. He popularized it. But Apollo 13, if you remember correctly, three men being sent to the moon, to walk on the moon, two of them. And here they are 200,000 miles away from the Earth, on the way to the moon. And some electrical wires that were exposed caught fire. And there was an explosion in the oxygen tank, and now the ship was crippled. It's losing power, it's losing electricity, it's getting cold, they're losing oxygen, and these men were about to die. And then they flashed to mission control, and you could see the flight engineer, and you could see a couple of NASA officials, and this is what the NASA official said. This could be the worst disaster that NASA's ever faced. And then, I'll never forget this, the flight director, Gene Kranz, his reply. He said, with all due respect, sir, I think this is our finest hour. You know, I've adopted that as my motto. And what I mean is, I'll tell you in just a second, but Apollo 13, as you know, they catapulted that thing through genius. They were running out of oxygen. They jerry-rigged some type of a carbon monoxide machine out of nothing to get it to work so that they could breathe. That shut down the electricity. That catapulted the thing. Remember what I said, your problems can catapult you? They catapulted around the back of the moon, back to Earth. The whole world was watching and clapped when that thing came down in the South Pacific and those men were safe. You see, it was NASA's finest hour. They took the biggest problem that was ever faced, one of the biggest problems ever faced by humanity, getting those men back from the moon with a crippled ship when they were just about dead, and getting them back safely. And I've adopted that as my motto because, you know what, there's always problems. There's always difficulties. Maybe it's not trying to get back from the moon, but I think about some of the sermons that I got to preach with some of the scriptures that I get. You know, it's easy when you get John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Well, I preach on that, but some of the ones that you get sometimes are really tough. And I go, how am I going to get up there in front of all these people and preach about that? And I'll hear this voice say, this is going to be a disaster. You know, it's that negative voice. And then I'll hear, oh, Cedric, this is your finest hour. It's amazing if you stay positive what can happen. I think about TV. and trying to get on TV. You want to talk about a problem. You want to talk about a barrier. You want to talk about a hardship. Here I am, a priest with a vow of poverty, with no money, no producer, no outlets, no programs. And I've got this vision to reach out beyond the walls of the church. I've got this dream. I've got this vision. But I've got a huge problem. It's like, how am I going to do this? I haven't got any money, for one thing. Never mind any programs, producers, or outlets to air them, even if I did. And here's what I discovered. You know what? When it comes to the impossible, God is in that business. But let me just say this. St. Francis of Assisi is quoted as saying this, whether or not he really did, but he said, if you do the possible, the impossible will become possible. See, you just do what you can do, and it's amazing how things start opening up, how levels start rising, how doors start opening. You see, you live with passion, you put one step in front of another, you can't see the future, all you can see is right here, and all you can do is what you can do. So I wrote books, I started to make contacts, the books produced money, I got permission to use the money to produce programs, stations started wanting my programs, and it's amazing what happened. See, remember the beginning of this talk, what I titled this talk? Challenges, yes, that was a challenge. Make champions. You're never going to know who you are until you